Good afternoon, everyone. I welcome all the participants and our today's resource person, Dr. S. V. Chaudhary, sir, to the session of the day, Simulation of Concrete Using Abacus, of our AICT-ISTE-sponsored online induction refresher program on innovations in concrete technology. I'd like to introduce our today's resource person, Honorable Dr. S. V. Chaudhary, sir. Sir is working as an associate professor in Thakur College of Engineering and Technology, Kandivali, East Mumbai. Sir completed his PhD on technology in civil engineering at VJTI Mumbai in 2017. Sir had 4 years field experience as structural consultant. Sir designed many residential and commercial buildings. Sir had published more than 15 publications in different national and international journals and conferences with more than 120 citations. So let us begin our today's session on simulation of concrete using abacus. I would like to request sir to start this session.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the introduction. Please give me the...
Yes. I'm giving. Okay, sir, you can share now.
Okay. So the today's topic, simulation of concrete by using abacus. Particularly, we will divide this into two parts. One, we will go for a little presentation, which I'll go through it at faster pace so that we will be able to concentrate on the simulation part, and we will see how to use abacus and rest of the things. So let me share this presentation. Okay. Sir, please confirm, is it visible?
Yes, sir. It is visible.
Okay. So today's this, as I said, we will go through a little faster. So the flow will be different available softwares and why we choose abacus for this particular purpose, then modeling of concrete using abacus, then case study, and then conclusion. And the conclusion will be exactly simulation using abacus only. Now, there are so many softwares available, some general finite element, abacus is also a finite element software. And there are available softwares like NSYS, that is CAE software package, then abacus, which we will be talking about. Then LS-DYNA is there, best known for explicit dynamic and crash analysis. Then COMSOL Multiphysics, this is also since not less than 15 years it has taken in academia. It is a good software. Then Midas Civil, this is also not new, but particularly in our country, it is new. Then MATLAB already is known to everybody. So out of all this, why we are choosing abacus? The basic reason, first of all, there are almost all softwares are compatible with some minor differences. Some may be giving direct values, some may be giving values with some formulation, or like that some minor changes are there. But according to me, the best software is the one you know how to use well, and it should fit in your budget. That is the only base software, because we have the bird in hand is better than birds in bushes, right? So whichever is available with us, and if we are unable to purchase other software, then naturally we are supposed to become expert of whichever is available. Then abacus licensing has changed to extended tokens, which is way cheaper than NSYS. Abacus, first of all, is cheaper than NSYS. Also, NSYS relies on partnership with DYNA for explicit, whereas Abacus has it integrated. You can switch from explicit to implicit between analysis step. While analyzing, you always can shift these two particular things. Then ANSYS Workbench is easier for beginners. However, it is difficult to get good mesh. Then when it is not properly meshing your object, then it will be very difficult to get the, what we say, mesh sensitivity. We are supposed to check for mesh sensitivity and then whether the solution is conserving or not, that also we are supposed to check by changing the mesh sizes. So that for that purpose, then we will have to go for the professional meshers like HyperMesh and ANSA like that. Then in terms of industry, Abacus has greater penetration in automotive, while ANSYS is preferred in energy industry. Now, let me clear here that Abacus, ANSYS, LS Dyna, COMSOL, and all these softwares are not designing softwares. These are analysis softwares. So if one is thinking that I'll be able to design something out of this particular software, no, these are analysis. This will give you the all type of stresses, strains induced in a particular object, whichever we will model in this. Then ANSYS interface is outdated by 20 years, whereas comparatively, Abacus CAE is better and more intuitive. Then ANSYS parametric design language is still useful, though, but you can get the same result using Python with Abacus. Nowadays, Python is roaring in programming. Well, R is also there. Then ANSYS doesn't offer API. API is application programming interface to interface with RST, that is result file. So if you are developing an application that depends on reading ANSYS result, then it will be a pain for you. Then Abacus offers a very good API, so you don't need to worry about the details on how the database is structured. Then people prefer to develop UMET in Abacus rather than ANSYS, as far as I am aware, because UMET is a subroutine. If we are very good in programming, then we always can go for UMET as a subroutine, where if we are supposed to change the material property frequently, then UMET option is very good. There only we are supposed to give the file name and everything will get incorporated in the software. My hint for good choice is have a look for whole family. Like what else is there to support along with this? You will need optimization, fatigue, multi-body, CFD, explicit, acoustic, electromagnetic, etc. So entire family we must see whether what kind of things this can handle. And whatever the software we are going to purchase or we are going to procure, that should have the maximum things. ANSYS comes with CFX Fluent, but you have to pay for all of them separately, which is again another pain to our pockets. Then Abacus comes with TOSA, FESAFE, SIMPAC, XFLOW, XM, and you don't need to pay for anything for them. It is all inclusive. It is worth mentioning that Aerospace Nastran is still the reference, and Academia COMSOL is getting increasing acceptance, particularly in Academia COMSOL, as I told you, since 15 years it has penetrated in Academia. Okay, now modeling of concrete using Abacus. So there are two methods which are generally being adopted. One is concrete smear cracking, and one is concrete damage plasticity. Third one is also there, that is a brittle cracking, but that is not generally adapted for the concrete. Now we will first talk about smear crack concrete model. The concrete model is a smear crack model in the sense that it does not track in individual macro cracks. Constitutive calculations are performed independently at each integration point of the finite element model. The presence of cracks enters into these calculations by the way in which the cracks affect the stress and material stiffness associated with the integration point. Smear crack concrete model provides a general capability for modeling concrete in all types of structures, including beams, trusses, shells, and solids, can be used for plain concrete, even though it is intended primarily for the analysis of reinforced concrete structure. Can be used with rebar to model concrete reinforcement, is designed for application in which the concrete is subjected to essentially monotonic straining at low confining pressure. This consists of an isotopically hardening yield surface that is active when the stress is dominantly compressive, and an independent crack detection surface that determines if a point fails by crack. Uses oriented damage elasticity concept, that is smear cracking, to describe the reversible part of the material response after cracking failure. Requires that the linear elastic material model be used to define elastic properties, and tension stiffening is another important factor in this. The post-failure behavior for direct straining across cracks is modeled with tension stiffening, which allows you to define the strain softening behavior for cracked concrete. We know when, suppose we are dealing with reinforced concrete section, and we know that under bending, the tension side of concrete will get cracked, and where we have provided the reinforcement. But that cracking of concrete doesn't mean that it has lost its everything. There must be some strain remaining, and we will have to take the advantage of that. That is being defined by in TOTO, we are using tension stiffening for this. This behavior also allows for the effect of the reinforcement interaction with concrete to be simulated in a simpler manner. Tension stiffening is required in concrete smear cracking model. You can specify tension stiffening by means of a post-failure stress-strain relation or by applying fracture energy cracking criteria. This we will see in further slide. This is the diagram of stress strain in tension zone of the concrete. In the beginning, from 0 to failure point, the concrete remains linear. When it reaches a tensile stress, then it starts, the strain is increasing, but stress is decreasing. This second phase is showing that it is not linear. So when we unload, it will not follow the same path, but it will follow from where we are unloading, it will follow the straight to zero, and that slope is not equal of initial path, and that is why it shows some failure. We will not get the same curve. It is not following the same curve. The choice of tension stiffening parameter is important in a better standard, since generally more tension stiffening makes it easier to obtain numerical solutions. That means your software will not get aborted before it gives you desired answer. And too little tension stiffening will cause the local cracking failure in the concrete to introduce temporarily unstable behavior in overall response of the model. And that is the reason while defining this tension stiffening, we will not bring this stress to zero, but we will keep it at 99%. Okay, it will come to near this strain axis. It will come to very, very near to the axis, but we will not give it as zero. Okay, that we will see when we will enter the values. Crack shear retention, as the concrete cracks, its shear stiffness is diminished. This is known to us. This effect is defined by specifying the reduction in the shear modulus as a function of the opening strain across the crack. You can also specify a reduced shear modulus for closed cracks. This reduced shear modulus will also have an effect when the normal stress across a crack becomes compressive. The new shear stiffness will have been degraded by the presence of crack. Now let us start, let us see how the concrete cube is modeled. A concrete cube is of size 150 mm is modeled in abacus using C3D8 element. This C3D8 element is three-dimensional, eight-noded brick element. A steel plate of thickness 25 mm is placed on top and at the bottom of the cube to ensure the uniform distribution of the compressive load applied. The plate is also modeled, this plate is also modeled with C3D8 element. The plates are secured in place by applying constraint type tie available in abacus. That is, in software, the constraint type tie is available where it will not allow them any friction slip or any slip between the two components if they are tied by using constraint type tie. Now, material properties. The material properties are as per IS 456 2000. And we have chosen M30 grade of concrete. So average compressive stress will be 30 MPa. Then ultimate strain, that is epsilon Cu, is 0.0035. And the strain at peak stress, that is denoted by epsilon 0 dash by 0.002. And then after, when modeling is done, this is actually the figure taken out. And first figure is showing the meshed block, that is cube, in our case, concrete cube. And it is clearly seen that there is a plate placed on the top of the cube and at the bottom of the cube. And the second figure shows the loading, which is placed uniformly in the form of pressure on top, and at the bottom, it was the constraints are given in the form of boundary conditions. And here we have used encaster. Encaster means fixed. We made the bottom fixed. So there will be no displacement, no movement, nothing is, no rotation, nothing is allowed. Data input. There are two options by which material properties can be incorporated for analysis in abacus. The first one is through CAE, and the second one is through input file, that is a Python script. Then input, the elastic option is used to give elastic property. The concrete option is used to describe compressive stress-strain relationship outside the elastic range. Here, plastic strain values, not total strain values, are used defining hardening behavior. This thing, when we will be using input file or we will be writing input file, then we are supposed to take care of this. Furthermore, first data pair must correspond with the onset of plasticity. The plastic strain value must be zero for the first pair. Now again, this is a tension steepening which we have already gone through. In Abaqus, plastic strain values, no total strain values are used. This is very important. We are supposed to remember this. Okay. Now, values for concrete properties. Here, a numerical expression which was developed by Hognestad was used. Here, what he suggests that this curve of concrete is this curve is divided into two parts. The part first, that is A to B, and second part is B to C. So A to B is non-linear portion, though in that first certain initial certain portion is initial, but it is not behaving in a linear way. This is non-linear portion, and then B to C is clearly linear, but it is after the peak point. And two formulas are suggested for 0 less than epsilon less than epsilon dash, which is 0.002, which we have already discussed. And for this portion, that means this non-linear portion, this formula is given. And for epsilon 0 is less than epsilon 2, epsilon cu, that means for up to the failure strain, this formula is given. So from formula itself, it is seen that this is non-linear and this is linear formula. And this total strain, that is epsilon, is the composition of elastic strain as well as plastic strain. What is elastic strain? Which is up to the elastic limit. Okay. Next, the failure ratios we are supposed to define. The ratio of ultimate biaxial compressive stress to uniaxial compressive ultimate stress. And that ratio here, default value is 1.16, or else we are supposed to perform the experiment and then calculate all these ratios. Or otherwise, if we take this, what we say, default values, that will also hold good. Absolute value of the ratio of uniaxial tensile stress at failure to the uniaxial compressive stress at failure. That is, we are considering that 10% is linear and this is total. So that is the tensile is 10%, and therefore default value is, but the default value is 0.01, which is very, 0.09, which is very near to 0.1. Ratio of magnitude of a principal component of plastic strain at ultimate stress in biaxial compression to the plastic strain at ultimate stress in uniaxial compression. The default value is again 1.28. The ratio of the tensile principal stress value at cracking in plane stress when the other non-zero principal stress component is at the ultimate compressive stress value to the tensile cracking stress under uniaxial tension, where this is default value is 1/3. Tension stiffening. In numerical simulation can be represented either by modifying stiffness of reinforcing bars or by modifying the stiffness of concrete so that the concrete can carry the tensile force after crack. This, as I told you, that after cracking, something is remaining, that is this after cracking some tensile force. The value of 0.002 is adopted for this particular analysis. The shear retention, this option is used to give a multiplying factor, that is rho, that defines the modulus of shearing of cracks as a fraction of the elastic shear modulus of the uncracked concrete. The first value is 1 and the second value is very large number for full retention. and these are the results after analysis. When mesh was of 25 size, then this was almost showing as the exact behavior of the concrete. Then when it was reduced to 18.75, again it is refined. Then at 15, is again it is showing optimum this thing, and at 10, the two final stress value is reducing. So optimum value we are getting at 15. So this way we are supposed to find out at which mesh the optimum value is we are receiving with whatever the data we are providing to the software. Otherwise, as we all know, every software has a tendency of garbage in and garbage out. So we need to be very careful, and well, it will take a few of the trials to get the correct value, but finally we get the correct value. Now, regarding damage plasticity approach, the concrete damage plasticity model is continuum damage model for concrete based on plasticity. The two main failure mechanisms, tensile cracking and compressive crushing of concrete material, are assumed in this model. The evaluation of yield or failure surface is controlled by two hardening variables. One is that is tensile equivalent plastic strain, that is epsilon T at plastic, and compressive equivalent plastic strain, that is epsilon C plastic, linked to failure mechanisms under tension and compression loading respectively. So these are the two graphs given in Abaqus documentation only. This is this shows the uniaxial tension, and this shows uniaxial compression. See, in case of smear crack model or smear crack approach, it was not linear, but it was segmental changes, like straight lines, then straight line, and then straight line. But in damage plasticity, the initial portion is linear, but then when we further increase load, the strain will increase, but stress will decrease. And that decrement is non-linear, and it is not following the straight line or segments. And again, when we unload, it will show the damage is already been occurred, and therefore we are supposed to consider this damage coefficients for, say, DT, which will be a damage coefficient for tensile portion. And in compression, again here some portion is linear. That linear, we will say that up to cracking it is linear. Once this is this starts non-linear way, it will reach to the ultimate stage, and then again the softening of concrete will start in compression zone also non-linear way. In this case, again, when we will unload, it definitely will not be parallel to the initial portion, but it will have a reduced one, and therefore the slope is reduced, and therefore we are supposed to consider the damage parameter, that is called DC in case of uniaxial compression. The model converts the stress strain curve into stress versus strain curves using the user provided stress versus inelastic strain data. See here, now when we are talking about this stress user provided, that means if we provide the wrong values, it will calculate wrong things. So that is the main idea behind using abacus. Abacus cannot be used by a layman. You need to be an engineer. You must be very well aware of the fact how the used material behaves and what are its engineering properties. All those things you must be known. And at the same time, with some experience, we should also know the output. We should be able to forecast the output. And if it comes near to there, then we may say, yes, whatever is being done is okay, it is in line. And then refinement can be done. The concrete specimen is unloaded from any point on strain suffering. This I just have told you. If E0 is the initial undamaged elastic stiffness of material, then the stress-strain relation under uniaxial tension and compression loading are, then this formula is also given in the Abacus documentation directly, so which we will be using for tensile and compressive stress with their plastic strains with using DT and DC as the damage coefficients or damage factors in tension and compression respectively. With this modeling approach, the concrete behavior is considered independently of the rebar. Effects associated with the rebar concrete interface, such as bond slip, dovetail action, are modeled approximately by introducing tension stiffening into concrete modeling to simulate load transfer across cracks through the rebar. Tension stiffening is required in concrete damage plasticity model. The tension stiffening can be specified by means of post failure. This is similar to smear cracking. This is exactly the same figure for tension stiffening. This initial stage, it will go linearly, and when further loading, the softening, here we will call it as a stiffening effect starts, but it is non-linear. Now, non-linear analysis of reinforced concrete beam by using damage plasticity approach. So this was a beam considered for the analysis. These values are not the full values because this beam actually was casted and tested by Buckhouse long back, and then after Wolanski have done its analysis by using ANSYS, and then we have done it with Abacus, the same beam, and because their dimensions are in inch and pound, and therefore these values are not full values. We would have taken 4,500 or 4,600, but it was converted. The section is also like that. Material properties. So the characteristic strength at 28 days, that is 33.095. Again, this value is converted, and that is why the fraction values are there. Then modulus of elasticity of the concrete, then Poisson's ratio, uniaxial tensile cracking stress. Here in this case, it was 3.585. Modulus of elasticity of steel is again the same, 200,000 MPa. Poisson's ratio is 0.3. Yield stress, that is Fy, you would have taken 415, but in that it is converted to 414. The stress strain curve shown in the figure, this figure, is given by MacGregor. He has given only one formula, which will take care of initial portion as well as later portion. So unlike Hognestad formula, there is only one formula which is clearly non-linear, and it gives a very good configuration of the concrete. And here epsilon zero is a strain at ultimate compressive strength fc. So these values are submitted, and this curve is done. So then properties, again these properties are getting repeated, this thing. But then concrete damage plasticity parameters like dilation angle, that is 32. Then potential eccentricity is 0.1. This we have discussed, 1.16. This is 2/3. And viscosity parameter is 0.1 here considered. Sometimes this viscosity parameter we will have to change if our solution is not converging. And this table is showing the value supplied to the software. As it was said, the first value of strain should be zero. So first pair, in the first pair of stress and strain, the first value is taken as zero. And stress, this is after the linearity ends, right? From here, non-linearity starts for the concrete. Again, this thing is assumed only because we have assumed that at this point, the linearity of concrete will end. And from this, the non-linear behavior will start. Then concrete compression damage. This is also by using those two formula which I have shown you before. By using that damage parameter DC, the crushing strain is calculated. Then concrete tension stiffening. This is not calculated as per the Abaqus documentation. This was calculated as per Quack's findings, and that suits the best. And that is why I have taken this. We will see the formula also. Then properties of steel. In elastic strain here, in our IS code for Fe415 or Tor steel, it is directly like this, it is given. And therefore, up to this, it reaches 415, where inelastic strain will be zero. And beyond that, it is horizontal to the x-axis, and therefore up to failure level, whatever we will consider failure level, up to that, whatever will be the strain, that strain we have chosen, that is 0.001744. These are the models created in this particular figure. If we see, we are able to see the reinforcement. These are the stirrups, these are the bottom bars, then top bar, this top support bars, and this bottom actual reinforcement. And this is with boundary condition, and this is the meshed one. So here only 1/4 of the beam is considered because of its symmetry. Only a quarter portion of the beam is selected so that we will be able to generate small size ODB file. Otherwise, it will generate the bigger one, and we are taking advantage of symmetry here. Okay, now when we'll talk about results, so Wolanski's results and my results are compared. So for when first crack form, it is almost in agreement, and the central line deflection is also in agreement. Whereas at failure, the both values are much more in agreement. Okay, so this shows that by using Abaqus, we will be able to simulate the plain concrete as well as the reinforced concrete. And this was actually the validation of my study. And then after I have used it for my actual work. So now we will see the actual software Abacus. Now, as in between I told you that Abacus is a finite element software, so 2-3 basic things are required to know. Well, the first thing is knowledge of finite element. At least fair knowledge of finite element is required. Secondly, if we are working with concrete, then concrete plasticity is very, very much required for this. We must know the concrete plasticity, how concrete behaves when it enters into plastic zone. And there are many books available, but the best one, I think, Concrete Plasticity by Hu, that is a Chinese author, Chinese or Korean. Okay. So, and computer knowledge is also required. That is the first. Okay, now I'll share again. So, well, before I share something, this Abacus software, if we purchase, then it may cost us in between 3 to 5 lakhs. But for learning purpose, a student edition is available. You can go to its website, register your name as a teacher, as a student, and you will be allowed to download the software. But it will have some restriction that for student edition, 1,000 node is the edition. Up to 1,000 nodes only we can, we always can model up to any number of node, but analysis will not be performed. So from that point of here, I am supposed to use student version only, because whatever I have used a full version of Abacus at the time of my PhD, that was in VJTF, that was a full version and I could use it. But here I have right now the student version, that is student version 14. But now if you go to the site and find out, then Abacus 2020 is also available. Okay, so let me share this. Is it visible, sir?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So when you will download the software from Dassault system, it gives you free access to all the documents and these softwares. If you are registered as a faculty or student, then when you will install, installation is very simple. Just, student version is very simple. The full version you need to install by using their guidelines. But for student version, just double click on setup file and it will take care of everything. Just go on clicking next, 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 and it will be done. Once it is done, then when you will open this, start this software, this is the first window you will get. In this, you will find that with standard explicit model or CFD model or electromagnetic model, which type of thing you want to analyze. So we will say with standard explicit, and this window will open. And here now, because of time constraint, I'll go a little fast, but there are several tutorials available now. Earlier, those tutorials were not available, but now the tutorials are available. So one can make good use of YouTube and learn these. So I'll show you how quickly and how fast we will be able to create our model. And then I'll take the ready-made model which I have already analyzed. But first, let me show you how to model. So first of all, when we will open this, we will go to the parts. Here we will open this window by double clicking. Here I will give the name as cube, some name, otherwise it will coincide with my this thing. Okay, so let us FDP only, cube FDP. And then a cube is a three dimensional thing, so we will keep three dimensional. Then deformable, yes, it is deformable. Then it is solid. And which type of, then it is not revolution, neither it is sweep. We know that extrusion. I hope that everybody is well aware with AutoCAD. So these things are used in AutoCAD. So we can say, okay, continue. And we will get one mesh. And now I want to draw here, say, one particular square. What is the size of square? 150 mm by 150 mm. Now one more, it reminded me to tell you that abacus is free from units. So we are supposed to take care of the units. If we are using mm, then throughout we are supposed to use mm only, everywhere. Secondly, if we are using Newton, then throughout we will use Newton only, right? Like that for all the units, because it is it doesn't have any unit. We are supposed to take care of unit. Consistency should be there. Otherwise, there will be a problem in, we will not be able to get the desired results. Okay. So there are so many things given, readily given for a drawing. I'll choose this rectangle, and well, I will choose the 0, 0 here at the bottom. Here you will find x comma y. So I'll say 0, 0, and my first point has been chosen. Now I'm supposed to choose second point, which I'll give 150, 150, and it is done. So now I want to see this, whether it is done or not. I'll say, okay, so I'll go to this square, which will auto fit. So yes, 150 by 150, but it is beyond this square, whatever the mesh, doesn't matter. We will say done. The moment we will say done, it will, there will be one pop-up window, and it will ask us to for the depth of extrusion. And here also we are supposed to give 150. And we'll say okay. And your cube is already done. So this way you can draw the cube at a faster way. Okay, we want to go for plate. So again, we will go for part two, that is, we'll call it as plate. This is also 3D, so let it be like that only. I'll choose again this. I'll go for this 0, 0. And again, it is 150, 150. Okay. I'll say done. But in this case, my thickness of plate is 25. So I'll say 25 and the plate is done. Now, after this, we are supposed to go for materials. When we will double click the material, one pop-up window will open, and how these properties are to be given or are given, that we will see in the already already done analysis. So I'll close this and we'll open that. So okay, I'll say open. We will be opening one already done, that is given cube one. Okay. That was this. Okay. No. So this is already done. So there are three parts. So one is cube, then second one is plate. So we need only two parts in this. So the part three is also a cube, but we need only two parts. Then when we go to material, in material, when we will double click, then this kind of window will open where we are supposed to write the name of material. In this case, we will write the material, then description and material behavior. So we will see them, whichever the already done. Now in this case, the material is concrete. Okay, and we, as we have discussed, we are using concrete smear cracking. So from where we will get this, that I will show you. The first one we will go for elastic. So from where this elastic will also come. So we'll go to mechanical, elasticity, elastic. Okay. So and when we'll click, this elastic will open and this window will open. Excuse me, just a minute. And the elastic properties are given like Young's modulus and Poisson's ratio, that whatever, but we are supposed to take care that everything should be in Newton mm. If we are following Newton mm, if we are following kilonewton mm, then everything should be in kilonewton mm. Okay, now then we will go to mechanical and here we will select plasticity. In plasticity, we have concrete smeared cracking, right? The moment we will choose concrete smear cracking, this will change and concrete smear cracking will come. And there we are supposed to apply this this value. This 10.8 value is taken because up to this level, we are considering that concrete will behave linearly. Beyond this, it is non-linear. And from there, we will calculate the plastic strain. Plastic strain will be the total strain minus elastic strain. So this, sorry, this plastic strain, and for all the values, these values we will get when we will create that curve. We have seen one curve by Hognestad. This is according to Hognestad. So beyond this 30, this is linear. So beyond this 30, the second phase after entering into plasticity zone, this is linear. So these values already by using Excel sheet we have calculated. So just are copy pasted here. Then failure ratios. So failure ratios are to be, as we have discussed, all default values we have taken. Okay. Then after failure ratios, shear retention. Shear retention, first value is 1 and the second value is the maximum, that is 10,000 I have taken. So that 100% shear will be taken care of. Then tension stiffening. Tension stiffening here, as discussed, 0.02 is taken. But when we will see the concrete beam, there according to quack calculations are taken. Okay, so this is first is 10 and 0.002. After this whole thing, this is for concrete. Then we will go for steel. Again in steel, as we have discussed, there are elastic, only one property given. Okay. Because we are not using any steel property, the plate is only placed there. So this is again one more thread which is open. We can consider this plate of more thickness, that is instead of 25, you can go for 100, so that there will be no deflection or deformation of plate take place, and giving all elastic plastic properties of plate, and then again simulate this very cube. So that is also possible. You can extend it. Okay, now after properties, now we will go to section. These sections are supposed to be, first we have taken as a cube. So if I double click it, here in section we are supposed to define the material. So material, there are two materials defined. So out of these two we are supposed to define one. So this is cube and it is of concrete, and therefore concrete was chosen. Otherwise, if you click here, so you will go to create material. Sorry. And then again, you will have to give all the values and then define the material. Well, if I click it here, see again it, then I'll go to elasticity, elastic, then plasticity to smeared crack here, that will come. So, okay, I'm not saving it. Here concrete is there, so okay. Then similarly for plate, it will show the steel and it is also okay. After this, again, we are supposed to come back to the part, and here we are supposed to go for section assigning. That means we are supposed to assign the section. Here cube is assigned, right? Just double click and it will ask what is the section, and then we always can, then it will ask me, just I have double click. So select the region to assign. So we will select the entire cube. This is to be assigned. Okay, done. So it will ask me the name of the section. What is that? So I'll just say cancel. Don't save. Okay. Otherwise it would have saved here one more. Similarly for plate, again, we are supposed to assign the section. Once it is done, either you can go for mesh or you can go for the assembly. In assembly, we always can select it from here. So there are three instances, right? What are those three instances? Cube 1, plate 1, and plate, second plate, which was copied while assembling this cube. There in assembly, we have all the options, like if I double click for assembly, all the options are available here. You can see if I click it, cube will be selected. I'll click plate, so plate will be selected. I'll click second plate, so this one. So what I have done, I have used this linear pattern. So in this plate was there, only one plate was there earlier. Then I have selected that linear pattern and given the dimensions and the selected the surface, which surface at what dimension I'm supposed to shift or keep, immediately it will be shifted. And your assembly will be ready. Then when we'll go to mesh, then naturally this whole thing will come into picture, and then it will ask separately which part of the this you are supposed to mesh. So here when we'll go to mesh for the cube, so now plates are removed, only cube is there. And in this case, when we go to drop up here, you will get controls. So what kind of control you are supposed to, whether it is structured, what I have chosen structured. So sweep means that is bottom up, and different type of controls you can have. Then orientation, element type. So when we will select element type, it will show us which type of element we want to go for. I have selected C3D8 by selecting 3D stress element. Okay. So that way you always can mesh it. I'll show you how to mesh for part 3. Okay. So here I'll remove the mesh first, all this. It is asking select, so I'm selecting the entire thing, and it said okay. Okay, so I'll go for this meshing. Suppose that is a, instead of 50, let us take 25. So if I say okay, it will ask me to delete the mesh, and the mesh is deleted. And at 25 mm, these nodes are created on the edges. Now I'll select the element type. Three stress, and there are different. Now you can select, instead of 3D stress, you can select hybrid, reduced integration, or wedge type. You can select different element, or tetrahedron, because this is three dimensional. So don't think about triangular and rectangular only. This is three dimensional, either wedge or tetrahedron type. So whatever type we will go, that it will take it and will go for. Then 3D stress, instead of 3D stress, you can select according to your requirement for what you are going. This is very simple. So 3D stress only was considered, and linear it was considered. If you go for quadratic, then it will get you the another type of this thing, that is C3D20, means 20 brick, 20 noded element it will select. But ours is a student version, so it will not allow us to go for the, so I'll keep it C3D8 and we'll say okay. And then I'll just click mesh. It will say mesh the part. I'll say yes. So the meshing is done. So meshing is a very simple job for the abacus. Then once the meshing is done, assembly is done, then we will go for the loading condition and constraints. So boundary conditions we will go for. See, this is boundary condition. Here we will go to load. So now assembled thing is available. So I'll go to boundary condition. I'll see base. The moment I'll click boundary condition, it will ask me to choose the surface, and I have chosen the base, the bottommost position by using this com facility. I have chosen this, and selected Encaster. In Encaster, everything is restrained. So I'll say okay, and it will be created, but it is already done. So I'm canceling it, and will again make the earlier one. When I'll go to load, if I double click, it will ask me what kind of load. You give the name, that is load 2, what kind of step it is. So this step I'll show you after this, so which is to be defined before defining the load, because boundary conditions can be defined in initial step, but load is not in initial stage. It is in second, when pressure stage we are supposed to take, or loading you can give the name. Then it will ask you which type of load, then pressure or whatever. Then if I say continue, in that case it will ask me to select the surface. Okay, I'll select this surface. Okay, I'll say done, and again it will ask me which kind of distribution you want: total force, hydrostatic, user defined, so uniform. Give the magnitude, and that is all. Okay, I am canceling it because it was already done. Okay, now in case of step, there are two steps. One is initial. By default, the initial step will come, and initial step will have the interactions, boundary conditions, and predefined fields. Right, so this is by default, it will come. The moment you will define your boundary condition, it will be included. Whereas in case of second step, you are supposed to create it by double clicking it. It will come step 2 always, because step 1 is initial step always. So step 2, so we are supposed to give the name here. Pressure is the name already given, and then we are supposed to select which kind of pressure we will be applying, that is static general. And when we will say continue, it will go to the pressure and here it will ask us description increments. So I have given maximum number of increments as 1000. So initial increment size is 0.001. The minimum size is 5×10⁻¹. And maximum is 0.001 again. Right. So this kind of, and I've chosen automatic and will say okay, but I'll cancel it. Okay. Then there is a field output request. What are the field output we are asking? So in this case, we are asking for stresses. I'll make it a little bigger one so that, okay. So stresses. So which kind of stresses you want? So I have just said stress. That is only one kind of stress. Then which kind of strain? So total strain, plastic strain, then equivalent plastic strain. So whatever this elastic strain, these kind of stresses, strains you can choose. Then displacement, so translation and rotation you can choose. then contact, so C trace, that is contact stress, and forces, that is reaction and concentrated force and movements, if any. And once you select all this, then just say, okay, I'm canceling it because already done. So after doing this whole thing, now you are supposed to go for job. Right? Here, I have already submitted the job for analysis. So we'll see that. So when we'll choose job here, we will get this job, and these all of them are aborted. Okay, so I'll select this whatever is aborted one, and we'll see what is the result. Okay, this means it is not found. So maybe second one, we'll say result. Now the entire this thing has changed, and now I want to see the result. So deformed shape, if I want to see, then it will show the deformed shape. This is stress chondra, the meiosis, that is four meiosis stresses. If I'll choose this second, then it will show some stress distribution. Show some distress distribution. Okay. Or otherwise, we can go back and do the analysis again. Okay. ODB field output. And this now we will choose the unique nodal and what kind of thing you want to see out of this, that I want to see the stress and that too. In vertical direction, because the forces are vertical, and I'll give the element node value, highlight that, and okay, let us give the 25 as the element, and we'll say plot. Then it is not done, that means okay, no problem. So this was not completed, and that is why it is not showing. Let me select another file. Say open, close ODB. This is okay. Open to open ODB. We'll say okay. Now that ODB is getting loaded, yes. And now if I select this, yes. So now we will be able to see the stresses. If I say S22, then it is because 11 is XX, 22 is YY, and 33 is ZZ. That is 1, 2, and 3 XYZ respectively. So I'll go for field output, we'll say continue, and we'll choose the stress S22, it is already chosen, and I'll say node label, and that is 25, and say highlight it, so that is this point, and we'll say plot. So one must have the patience when working with finite element software. We don't know how much time it will take. So if you can see here, it is the plot is already done and it is almost touching 30. See, and it gives negative values because it is compressive. So in Abacus, compressive values are in negative. Tensile values are in positive, with positive this thing, without negative sign. So now you always can choose this this plot. You can edit this data from here. This value, you can say edit. So everything you will be able to control A, or you can choose full thing, control C, and bring it to any other whatever Excel sheet, and you can draw the curve according to your requirement. So this is how the concrete cube is modeled and analyzed. So it is very difficult to show everything within the short time. Now I'll show you that beam, how it was modeled. So before we go to beam, let me stop sharing this. New share. So this Excel sheet I have prepared for properties. This is the formula. Now this is the formula according to MacGregor, and then according to that formula, this strains are considered from 0.0001 to whatever our desired 0.0035 and beyond. Okay, and for that, these values we have already seen in presentation. Those values I have kept here as it is, and then this stress is calculated by using the formula. This formula is applied, and this formula is applied, and the whole thing is calculated. So we have stress and strain for entire concrete, whatever we have taken in the account, and this graph can be plotted. Okay. This is plotted by using these values. Now, after this, elastic strain is calculated. What is elastic strain? That is stress upon modulus of elasticity. And then inelastic strain is calculated, that elastic strain minus, sorry, this total strain minus elastic strain. And up to this level, we are considering that it will behave as linear, and then after it will be non-linear, and therefore the first value of elastic strain, inelastic strain, is zero, and then this damaged coefficient DC was calculated by again that formula. We have seen that formula, and then corresponding plastic strain, right? So all these values are calculated. Now, when we will go for the tension stiffening is according to Quack, and that he has given this formula, but the formula clearly said that the values are in pound and inch. So the mesh size is converted into inch, and then it was this formula was used and then calculated the yield stress and the cracking strain, and these values are supplied to the abacus where the tension stiffening is required, and this up to 99 it was not taken one and to 0 to 0. So like this the values are calculated. There's some manipulation you can say, but that is required. Otherwise this kind of graph you will have to generate. It should go according to this. Here you are free to take in between values, but I have chosen only three values. Okay, so we will see that. Let me stop sharing this. We will see that again in abacus. We will see that where it has gone. It is opening, it is taking little time. In a minute or two, it will open. Then I'll share. Yes. Yes, here there are different parts because this is beam and it will need the concrete beam. This was a quarter beam is only modeled. Then there is bar one, bar all bars are same. Then plate. This plate is showing very big in the because this is only one. So with reference to its own this thing, it is taking entire screen, but it is a very small plate. This I'll show when we will see the assembly. See, that is this plate. This plate is placed here to apply the loads, and there is one more plate which is placed in the bottom. You can see this in the at the bottom for support. Okay, now if I show this is very very simple actually when you will work on it. So I'll just save and we'll make it transparent. So see all this you will have to play with what is where. Otherwise, by looking at this only once, it will be very difficult to learn. So these are the stirrups, and these are the beam. This is beam, and these are the bars. Inside bar, see this is that bar, and all these are created, assembled, and then meshed. So if I go to mesh, so I'll get this mesh. So here the mesh is of very small size, and because it is beyond 1000 nodes, so I'll not be able to show you the results, but this analysis is, you can go by, you can, well, you can reduce this mesh size and reduce the number of nodes, and you always can learn this and use for your research. With this, I'll stop sharing. Okay, if there are any questions, over to you, sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Participants, if you have any questions, you can ask. If anyone has any questions, you can type in the chat box or you can unmute yourself and ask.
Well, right now, it will be very difficult to understand also. And well, this is a post-lunch session again. So, well, yes, anyway, okay. If anyone or anybody or all of you want to work on Abacus, I'll be very happy to be a part of your team.
Yes, thank you, sir, for conducting such an informative session on simulation of concrete using Abacus. Your session was very interesting, and I'm sure all the participants have thoroughly benefited from your session. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Namaskar.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, I think someone has a question.
Yeah, yeah, I think. Ask. Yogesh sir has a question.
No, sir. I say thank you. Thank a lot. Thanks a lot.
Okay. Okay, I'll be sharing the feedback link in the chat for the participants. Sir, you can leave now.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes.
Bye.